here before I did. Thank you for allowing me to join your revolution. This is wonderful. Thank you. I'd like to introduce two family members with me today. My granddaughter, Linda, is standing over here. Celebrate our 55th anniversary tomorrow. They said, yeah, they would get 30 or 40 people on today, so I'm very glad you showed up. This is wonderful, but it's also very encouraging because, as I see it, we are in a desperate struggle right now on which way our country's going to go. But I've been very encouraged. There's a lot of people, especially when we talk to those individuals under 30. but there will be some, even in this audience, and certainly in support of what we're doing, that are over 30, but a lot of them have... but we have to admit, freedom is a young idea, and that's where the enthusiasm comes from. So. The message is not brand new. It can always be refined, but it's been around for a while. And fortunately for us, we were able to live in a country that had been blessed with the concept of liberty and a good constitution. But we've also been given a job because it's been neglected for the last 100 years, and what we need to is restore confidence in the cause of liberty, restore confidence in our constitution. A significant group in any society that retains the beliefs and confidence what made the society great. And I keep thinking about the individual Solzhenitsyn. In the midst of the Soviet system, he was born in the year the revolution occurred. Yet he lived through that tyranny. And I always marveled at the fact that he came out, he was well educated, he had religious beliefs, he knew English, and he knew the classics, and he knew something about liberty, in spite of the tyranny. So there's always that group out there. And I don't think that we are getting the young group and the college age group energized, but there's a lot that have known about this and have felt frustrated in the past, that have not had a spokesman, and they have been just disgusted with the fact that too often we elect one party versus the other and not a whole lot changes. But we make a change. But in order to make the changes, we have to know where the flaws are and what we have to do. You know, last night, some of you may have seen, there was a little interview with Larry Kudlow he was complimentary in a sense that he was talking about the monetary issue and maybe restoring a sound dollar to this economy. Yeah. And he actually was trying to pump it up a little bit and was talking about the Ron Paul gold dollar. But obviously it's not the Ron Paul gold dollar. The gold dollar has been around for about 6,000 years. It's this paper money. The complete paper money has only been around 40 years, and it's done a lot of damage, and it's on its last legs, let me tell you. So there is no doubt that we do want to end the Fed, but I'll tell you what. Too much about if, we might have to be concerned about when, but all we have to do is get that full audit of the Fed, and the people will end the Fed. The founders understood something about central banking. They understood understood something about inflation because they had the runaway inflation of the continental dollar. They were explicit in the Constitution, only gold and silver could be legal tender. They could not print money, they were explicit about that. They could not emit bills of credit, and they gave no authority for a central bank, which is the Federal Reserve. So we're operating on an unconstitutional system of money, and it has brought us this havoc, because it brought us the financial bubbles, and it's also brought us this recession, depression of the last 4 years. So we cannot solve our problems and get back on economic growth unless we address the subject of monetary policy. And that's one thing that the American people are paying a lot more attention to now. This is the first time in 100 years history of the Federal Reserve that the Federal Reserve is an important issue in a presidential campaign. Money and money that's been around for about 6,000 years is being weird and unusual, and yet doesn't it appear that maybe just printing money is weird? I mean, just putting numbers on money and calling it, money is a piece of paper and calling it money. Now that's something really very weird. But the other reason there's such resistance to this, we've heard it expressed a few times because I think even on national television, sometimes they're impolite to me. Have you ever noticed? there's been claims, and along with those of us all together, they claim that we are dangerous. Occurred in 1913. The total removal of any restraint on the printing and the printing of money occurred in 1971, and government has expanded exponentially. The debt has expanded exponentially. The money supply expanded exponentially, and of course, our wealth has been drained exponentially as well. And the one characteristic about a sound currency in a free market is the middle class is large and prosperous. But today, the middle class is poorer and smaller, especially in the last 4 years. The destruction of a currency, the systematic debasement of currency, just the process will take wealth from the middle class and give it to a privileged elite class. That was occurring even through the last 40, 50 years that has happened. But it became especially noticeable when we had our crisis in 08 and 09, because who came to the rescue? The Fed, that created all the problem. They printed a lot more money, and they bailed out all their friends and dumped all the debt on the American people and on the middle class, and they lost their jobs. So this is the reason the money issue is so important, because what it does, it enhances the growth of government. When government grows, liberty is diminished. And this is what we're suffering from today. Liberty can solve our problems, and following the Constitution would be the way to go about it. But we need to have some fundamental changes in our understanding of exactly what it means to be free and how we protect those liberties. You know, for a while, I think there's been a disintegration of this understanding and a lackadaisical attitude, and we concentrated more on the material benefits of a free society and forgot about the fundamentals of a free society and sound money. But something else happened approximately 100 years ago. Not only did the monetary system change and the foreign policy change, but there was a division in the understanding of liberty. They chopped liberty into pieces. One they call economic liberty, you know, free markets and how you spend your money, and one group will defend this rather well. But then there's another group that defends personal liberty and personal habits and social liberties, and yet both sides don't defend both sides. I think what we have to do is understand that the concept of liberty is unified. Your right to your life and your liberty means that you have... so you choose, but you also should have the right to keep the fruits of your labor. Washington assume that freedom is too risky for the people because they won't take care of themselves. But just think, even if you give credit to a few of them being well-intentioned, look at the results. The results are lousy. I would say that I'm going to bet on you and the rest of the people in this country to take care of yourselves a lot better than the government can take care of. People who have wanted to make sure that everybody had a house said, had designed this program, print money, easy credit, and then have affirmative action type programs and force banks to make bad loans. At the same time, give Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac special privileges that created a bubble. But yes, a lot more people had houses. Some people had two houses. It looked great. The price of houses was going up. People borrowed more against their houses. And nobody except the free market Austrian economists recognized that there was a bubble out there. A lot of people made money during that time, and then they got into the speculative business with derivatives and made billions of dollars. The inevitable collapse of the bubble came, and guess what? The Federal Reserve came to the rescue. They bailed out the people who had been making all the money. They dumped that debt on us, on the middle class. The middle class lost jobs and lost the houses. So they cannot do this. They cannot provide free stuff. I mean, there are theirs that think that you can get free education, free medical care, free food, and free houses. But it doesn't work. You're the old-fashioned way, you have to work for it. Without a certain sound currency. Today, anybody who wants to take care of themselves are punished, because if you try to save money and make 1% and inflation rates are 5 and 6 and 7%, you lose. So it's designed to hurt savers. Matter of fact, the opposition to the free market economists, I literally say savings are bad. We want you to spend the money. The only thing that stimulates the economy is spending money. And if you go broke and have too much credit card debt and you won't spend, then it's the obligation of the federal government to spend more money. If they don't have it, then they print the money. It's an absolutely bizarre economic theory that you're witnessing the total failure of right now, and it'll be up to you to replace it with something different, and that is free markets, property rights, and following the Constitution. Start off with a token cut the first year, cut the budget by $1 trillion. But you know, all this sounds good, but you really do have to get the endorsement of the people. People have to think it's in their best interest to allow this to happen. If we don't reverse it, we're going to go off a cliff, because you can't keep spending, borrowing, and printing money and continue to do what we're doing. And I think that's what's happened to the country these last 4 years, this recognition. We have to ask the important question that the founders asked way back. They asked the question, what should the role of government be? And they came down with the conclusion, it shouldn't be the role of the king. We want to get rid of the king. Because we have the dictatorship of the majority. If the majority can get together and gang up on the producers, they do it. They undermine our personal liberties as well as they undermine our economic well-being. So we cannot accept this notion that 51% can rule over the minority, because that is what's happening. Yeah. The country is now bankrupt and it isn't going to last much longer. If we ask the important question about what the role of government ought to be, it should be rather simple. defend Nothing. Liberty. That's what I'm seeing the consequence of having welfare from cradle to grave. We found out in the last century that communism and radical socialism is a total failure. But the system we have today of radical welfareism and interventionism isn't working either. So we have to reject this notion that more people can be taken care of by government planning and economic intervention. But there's another major issue that we have to deal with if you want to cut spending. As a matter of fact, I think it's the place where we should start. It should be the easiest place. And that is this outrageous spending overseas in the war zone. Because they were right. They said that you can't go to war unless there's a declaration. No more wars without a congressional declaration. We need to know. Said that the best thing to do is stay out of the internal affairs of other nations. Don't go into nation building. We have the wisdom nor the money to be the policemen of the world. That's open. Now, what would be the consequence of this? We'd have a stronger national defense, not weaker. We wouldn't become more vulnerable. We would be bringing our troops home, and the military personnel they would be spending their money here at home instead of in Germany and Japan and Korea. Tragic what's happening. Of course, they would like to paint those of us who don't believe we should be fighting all these wars as lacking patriotism and not supporting for the troops. But they fail to remember too often the fact that our campaign gets more money from the active military people. I see the veterans coming home and supporting our cause. They've been there. They've been on the fighting line. And then they're coming back and they're suffering. They don't get the treatment they need. And so many need the require, you know, need some help. And right now, we're in an epidemic of suicide, of people coming back from all the trauma that happened over there. I saw some statistics the other day. You know, you think of World War II and Vietnam, that the military, oh, they were under terrible conditions. But compared to the time that you're under stress and potential death in combat, it's about 1,000 hours compared to 100 hours in the other wars. So it is because the war goes sort of unnoticed, very, very stressful. And it's included millions of Americans. And just think of the consequence of those who lost their lives and their families, the ones that are coming back that are crippled, as well as the people who are looking for help. It is a major problem. That has to cease. We can't afford it. It makes no sense. We need to get these wars over with. We need them stopped. System, the welfare system could not be financed if we had to pay taxes every month and pay for these bills. But seductively, they borrow and pay it later on, and they print the money and they delay the cost. I used to talk about the next generation will bear the cost. I don't talk that way. We're paying the cost right now. That we should be very leery of these wars when they're not declared. They just go on and on. But during a wartime, people have traditionally been more willing to give up some of their personal liberties. I've come to the conclusion that you never have to give up personal liberties for more security. Nevertheless, that's always a challenge, certainly after 9/11. We all understood the stress and the trauma that came from that. But it wasn't an excuse to give up our liberties. There was no excuse to pass the Patriot Act after 9/11. If the Patriot Act had been called to repeal the Fourth Amendment Act, it would have never been passed. And that's what it has done. But not only have we lost so much of our personal liberties here at home, they're systematically being undermined still. We lost so much with the Patriot Act, a loss of our privacy, invasion of our emails and all correspondence and financial records, but it continues. 1 year ago, our president announced that it was official policy that the United States government could assassinate an American citizen without a trial. Executive order. Guess what? A constitutional president could reverse that by reversing that executive order. Another piece of legislation was passed. You know, the intrusion into the affairs of others and the use of our CIA has been more or less out of control for a long, long time. But at least they had the brains to know it was illegal and they kept it secret. But now they are so bold when you think of the National Defense Authorization Act, they're coming out. And what it says is the military can arrest an American citizen with no charges, no trial, and also that they could be held indefinitely in a secret prison and who knows where. That's getting pretty close to the Enabling Act. I think it's very, very dangerous. It has to be reversed if we want to live in a free society. At our airports that we're derelict in our duties. Here we see federal agents without proper permission groping and x-raying and prodding and groin checking and everything in the world. And for us to look at those pictures, and if we accept this, the whole thing is, it didn't make us any safer. It doesn't make any safer. It teaches us just to be submissive to the state. That's what has to be stopped. That contribute to this attitude that the federal government can run and trample over our rights. It's the wars against the American people here at home. It's the drug war that has driven so many people. So the drug war needs repealed as well. Century, and that was the prohibition of alcohol, at least back then. Back then they thought they had to amend the Constitution to put all those prohibitions on people. Now they just do it. But that was a bad experiment, and finally the country woke up and repealed it. And we really need to do that. As a physician and a person in politics, let me tell you, when people are addicted to drugs and have to go out and kill and rob to get that addiction fed, that's a lot. We treat drug addiction a lot different than we treat alcohol addiction. Yeah, even that's a drug too, and a deadly drug. Yeah. So once again, it's back. The drugs are very, very dangerous. dangerous, alcohol is dangerous. It's back to who's supposed to protect us from ourselves? Who's supposed to take care of us? Who's supposed to teach us? For children, it should be the parents, and we have to have the responsibility. That bureaucrats and politicians have our best interests at heart. That's a failed policy. But there is a revolution going on in this country, and it's a delightful one. The young people are coming out, as well as those who remembered a better day, and we have a great tradition, we have a constitution that we can look to, and this is what's happening in the country. I don't know exactly what's going to come out of the campaign, but I know that Colorado can offer a tremendous boost to the cause of liberty. Freedom provides so many answers for us because it's based on tolerance and bringing people together. People come together because they want their freedom, and they're not arguing over how they want to use their freedoms. We don't argue over how you want to practice your religious beliefs or you don't want to practice, but we want religious freedom to bring people together. That's the way it should be with all social, personal issues, to bring people together. This because if you legalize freedom of choice, then you endorse the way the people use it. But we don't do that. We don't endorse what people do with their religious freedoms. But we recognize that this is the principle of us assuming responsibility for us and running our lives as we so choose. That's what freedom is all about. Yeah! Seeking of virtue and excellence. When governments get involved in divvying up and passing out excellence and virtue, watch out. But when they do attempt, which they're doing it all the time, you know, perfect economic equality and teaching people what their habits ought to be and doing it all the regulate. When they do that, they only can do it at the expense of liberty. And they expend the liberty, but they accomplish no goals. It's no better than when they try to give everybody a free house. I mean, the results are bad. But today is an opportunity. We're living in a time where this 50, 60, 70, especially since the Depression, this experiment in economic intervention and planning and fiat money, the failure is on the table, it's there, something has to replace it, and I know what we ought to do. Work, how sound money works, how contracts work, why the government should be limited as the founders believe. We don't have to invent anything new. It's been around for a long time. And the greatest experiment has been in the United States. We had the largest, richest, free middle class ever. But as I said, the middle class is shrinking and the country is getting poorer, and a lot of the wealth you see around is based on debt. We owe too much money. That's why we have to cut back. We have to reassess the role for government. And if we do that, and if we did it by saying, look, if you're in debt, nobody gets a bailout. The debt gets liquidated. Corrections that occur, we could all go back on our feet again. I've been convinced that if I had a choice of living in a free society and being poor, I'd want to still live in a free society. Unfortunately, we don't have to make that choice. The freer the society, the more prosperous society is. It doesn't take a majority to bring about changes. It takes an irate, determined minority. Keen on starting brush fires of liberty in the hearts and minds of men. And that is what's happening. The brush fires are starting. They're appearing everywhere. We can't even count them, and that's the way it should be. It's not top down. It's grassroots up. It's the cause of liberty, and we will prevail. Thank you very much.